All right. Yeah, guys. So this course will take 2 months, approximately 2 months. The tools we are covering part of the course, open the PDF, right? So I will go through at high level. So definitely we'll see what is DevOps, why DevOps, opportunities in DevOps. And then we slowly get into the tools, DevOps tools. Version control, which is Git. Then Maven, that is to build applications, okay? And managing artifacts. We'll see what is that in the course. So when you build applications, it creates packages. The packages could be var, jar, exe, ear, right? We call them artifacts. So we need a server to centrally manage those artifacts. So that Jenkins, one of the important DevOps automation tool everybody should know. Jenkins, it's open source, it's very popular, and we will learn Jenkins, Ansible, that's configuration management tool, right? Meaning, for example, I have 100 virtual machines. On 100 virtual machines, I want to install Java. So I can use Ansible and automate that process. But more about that later in the course. And Docker. So very, very, very important. So Docker, what is Docker? How to Dockerize and how to run applications on Docker containers. That's very, very important. And Kubernetes. So I guess most of you heard about Kubernetes. So it's a container orchestration tool. So it's a orchestration tool which manages hundreds, thousands of containers in production environment. So if no Kubernetes, no job for you. Okay, that important it is and that hot it is. So now every DevOps, majority of DevOps profiles, DevOps jobs, right, based out of Kubernetes. So we're going to see what's Kubernetes and lightly, okay, at lighter stuff, monitoring and log management, followed by Linux essentials. Yeah, having knowledge on Linux is also important. So Linux essentials. We're not covering this much, but yeah, Slack anyways, we cover in Jenkins, and Agile, we cover in the introduction of the course. So Jira, we will see. So even though we mentioned it, we'll see if time permits, we go with that. Okay, or I will include this. Why not? Why we should skip that one? So that's about the course. It takes 2 months and we go very advanced, right? So that you can switch your profiles, switch your job roles. Maybe some of you working on testing, some of you working on Linux, some of you Windows admins, or maybe someone who doesn't have jobs and you have 3 years gap, 4 years gap. So for all of you, the course will be very useful. And are there any prerequisites? No prerequisites. So if you put your focus on the course, right? You're there, you're done. So, and about graduation, what should be the education background, all that. So any bachelor's degree is enough. You don't have to be BTECs, MTECs, MSCs, MCAs. It could be BA, BCom, MBA, right? It could be any. Minimum bachelor degree is required. And no prerequisites. Anybody who is keen and who plans properly can easily succeed in this. Now, I want to listen from you. So what's your questions now? The people ask me, will there be coding? So will there be coding? How many of you are afraid of coding here? Be interactive, please. Speak up. It's the forum where everyone should speak, not just me.
Okay, Hari. Suvin here.
Yeah, Suvin.
My question is not about the coding part. Would you be able to cover each and every topic which is mentioned in over the topics?
Yes.
Because it has a lot of things. Would you be able to cover each and everything?
Yes, Suvin.
Okay.
Yeah, otherwise it won't help you.
Okay.
See, if tomorrow after completing the course and you are making a resume with 5+ or 6+ whatever, or 3+ or 2+, and if you don't cover things in detail, it doesn't help you.
Yeah, I understand.
You can't crack job.
Yeah.
And if you know what is what, then it becomes a very basic level training. And it doesn't help you to work on projects. It helps you to talk about what is DevOps all that, but it doesn't help you to work on projects.
Yeah, great.
We should go a little depth, no doubt. And if you are into a different technology, okay, and you need hands-on. Believe me, I believe in doing small things, okay? So every day or every session, after every session, in a day, plan for practice and preparation, very important. So without practice, without preparation, you can't achieve anything. If something comes easy, it also goes easy. So trust me, no special skills required. No talent required for this. You need a commitment, a plan, and practice. I strongly believe in practice, not in talent. So if you plan it, you're there. You will definitely succeed, no doubt. 100%.
Thanks, Gary. And my second question, I don't know whether I can ask here.
No problem.
I took AWS as well.
Uh-huh.
So when will you start it and what is the timeline for that?
So if you enroll for weekends, right, Suvin?
Yeah, right.
It will be same timings,
yeah,
after DevOps.
So 2 more months, totally 4 months.
Yeah, you're right. If you have time and you want to plan other course parallelly in some other timings, let me know. I can help you.
No, I can't join any of the course at the moment. Fine. Thank you.
No problem.
That's me.
So others, please.
Excuse me, sir. So yes. Do we need to be expertise in all these tools, or is there any specific tools we'll be good to go or, you know, to the resume?
Okay, so I will tell you the key tools are Kubernetes, Docker, Jenkins. You should focus mainly on those tools.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. Kubernetes, Docker, Jenkins. And
along with AWS, is this fine to show in resume?
See, it depends. If you are showing both, then you should be good at both.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. You should be good at both. Yeah. And hell lot of opportunities. So people are shutting down their mobiles, getting irritated by calls, okay? Lots of opportunities, huge, lot of scope. It's going to be there for decades, I believe. Decades, it's not something which will last for 3 years or 4 years. It's going to be for decades. And it's highly paid job too.
Okay.
Sir, this is Sandeep. Okay, so what if along with this training, so I mean, for in the market, somebody need to have certification on this? I mean, like any, do all these courses offer certification, or what is the importance of certification for any of these courses, like for job seekers?
Sandeep, yeah. See, certification is not mandatory.
Okay.
At least DevOps space, definitely companies doesn't accept, expect certification, but cloud they may. That's also not mandatory.
Okay.
Under DevOps, right? There is no single certification for total DevOps. You have certification for Jenkins.
Right.
You have certification for Kubernetes.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, so certification is not that important, but if you are passionate about doing it, it's your choice now. Yeah, any other questions?
Hello, sir.
Yeah, Hari.
Sir, how much effort we should put to expertise in Kubernetes or Jenkins or Docker, sir? Like how much effort, like in this 2 months, how much effort, like is it okay with what we do in course, or we should go for advanced? Like if we want to go for advanced, like how should we search for resources? Like I want to know all this.
Okay, Harry. See, how much efforts? I recommend you plan at least, if you are not working, okay? If you're not working, I suggest you plan at least 3 hours a day for practicing and learning. If you can do it four, that's good. 3 or 4 hours a day. 1 hour training, weekends, three hours, right? And the whole week you have time.
Yes.
So you spend 3 hours a day in practicing, maybe do it again and again if you have time, no harm in it. So 3 hours a day would definitely help you in any aspect.
How about hands-on, sir? If you want to go for...
Hari, see, if I show something today, you do it, you repeat that at home. That's what hands-on is.
Okay. And sir, if I want to explore anything, like is it possible to know apart from course, like if I search in somewhere, is it possible to get resources from?
See, now online is a resource. Google
yeah,
is
yeah. Yes.
Yeah. You can do it, but you can do it. That's not a big deal.
And I'm completely from mechanical background, sir. Like I worked in an automobile company for 6 years. Six years. I want to switch into software because of pay and all. Is it okay?
Definitely okay. You forget that you're from mechanical.
Yes.
Okay. So see, no. See, simple, straight point. You're from mechanical, you're from MBA, you're from BA, you're from BCom. Nothing matters.
Okay.
How you plan next 3-4 months matters.
Okay.
That's what matters. You forgot about your percentages. Maybe you are a below average student. That's okay.
I will add to that point. I'm myself Sandeep. I'm working on company Oracle. And recently, I'm working on a project where people have joined on mechanical, electrical, or MBAs, who have done the certificate, courses and certification. I mean, I'm speaking from my experience. So that's not a matter. The only thing is that you should be knowing things.
Okay. Okay.
Thanks for adding that, Sandeep.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So do not think. See, do not question yourself about is this okay? Is that okay? So you should stop questioning yourself. You should start planning yourself. You should start doing.
Okay.
Nothing is an obstacle. Nothing.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. And a little bit about me. I have I'm in IT for about 15 years. I started my career in 2006 as a Java developer, and I was into Java for about 8 to 9 years. I played different roles, like a developer, a lead, architect, and then I got into DevOps and cloud. I worked on mainstream projects, and I also worked on so many freelancing projects coming to DevOps and AWS. Okay, that's about me. And my passion is training. When I joined as a junior developer in 2006, right? Before I begin my career, I had plans to set up a training institute. As per plan, I executed, things are going good, and that's about me. That's about me. And every day, I do lots of hands-on. I get in touch with many different people from US, UK, India. They reach me saying, I want this task, I want that task. So I'm a guy who always keep my hands dirty. So that's about me. So as for my experience, right? As for my experience, so what you did till today doesn't matter. Really doesn't matter. You may be excellent, that doesn't matter. You may be average or below average, that doesn't matter. So what you do from now matters. So how you plan matters. So planning is so important, okay? Plan it, stick to it. 4 to 6 months, okay? Stick to it. So your 4 to 6 months of efforts will pay off, and you'll have definitely nice jobs, good package, nice family life, everything. Trust me. I do not believe in talent. No, I do not believe in anything. I only believe in hard work and practice. That's all. Yeah. So now let's get into the subject. Right, so what is DevOps and why so many people talking about DevOps? Why it has become that popular? Why it has so many opportunities? Why it is highly paid? Okay, let's see about it. And no one can explain DevOps in one sentence or two sentences, okay? And if you ask what's DevOps to 10 people, most likely you get 10 different answers, and all 10 are correct. Means, why I'm saying this, there's no a definite definition for DevOps, okay? So DevOps means many things, okay? So DevOps means many things. So we cannot explain DevOps in one line or two lines, okay? DevOps means many things, okay? Now let's slowly get started about what it is. What all we do in DevOps, okay? And what is its objective, all that, right? So it's all related to your software development, right? So today, every business is tightly coupled with a software. So let's say you want to start a business, let it be a retail business, let it be a food business, let it be anything, sir, any business. Finance business, any business today, everything is tied up with a software, a training business, right? Everything is tied up with a software. So software is so important. It has become part of business now, right? That's what the software companies and software engineers and we all handle, right? Right. Now, okay. Fine. Let's start like this. So we are working for a customer building a mobile application. We means, I don't think we are writing code here. We means we are DevOps, we are DevOps, and we're gonna have testing. We're gonna have developers, we're going to have architects, we're going to have managers, business analysts, product owners, many, many people, right? So developers, what they do, they develop software, they write code. That could be Java, .NET, PHP, Python, anything. We don't care. As a DevOps people, we do not care because we are not going to deal with application code. And so they write code on their local machines, and we need to integrate, right? We need to integrate changes made by all developers. How do you integrate that? There are tools called SCM, for example, Git. So these guys, they use a central Git or central source code management tool to integrate the code. Okay, let me leave it here. And let me highlight software development lifecycle. So what is software development lifecycle? Can you help me? What all phases we have in software development lifecycle?
Requirement gathering.
Yeah.
Developing.
See, requirement gathering. Then
design,
analyzing.
Yeah.
I would say analysis and design. Important, right?
Yeah, and implementing and implementation, implementing.
So yeah, implementation.
And then testing.
Testing.
Deploying.
Yeah. Releasing or deploying. Yeah.
Whatever.
Right. These are the phases. So in a software development lifecycle, there will be requirement gathering and analyzing and designing and implementing, testing, and releasing that software to customers. Right. So what is the time? What is the time span of software development lifecycle as per your experience? Please.
Pardon?
I mean,
depends on project.
Yeah, so I want you to share your experience.
1 year.
Okay, others? Okay. This cycle, right? From requirements till releasing that to customer. Okay, 1 year. Anybody else? See, it could be different, I know, but I want you to share your experience if you have any.
One sprint, one agile sprint, like 2 weeks.
Okay, 2 weeks.
Sometimes it is 3 months, one quarter.
3 months, 6 months, 4 months, etc. See, only after DevOps came into picture, this has come into picture, like agile, 2 weeks, 1 week, daily release, all that. But when DevOps was not there, this is not there. Okay, I'll come to that. Okay, tell me, if customer comes to you, I mean, when I say you, not directly to you, to your team, your manager or someone. When a customer comes to you and asks for new features and you'll tell him, yeah, customer, we will do it. And we will release it in 1 year? Will customer be happy?
Oh.
He won't be happy. Why? Today's market is so dynamic. If you make some business decision now, it will be stale after 1 year. There's no use of it after 1 year, right? So now, right? No. Maybe 10 years back, 15 years back, 20 years back, 1 year releases make sense. 6 months releases make sense. But in current situations, 1 year releases doesn't make sense. So customer wants that new feature as early as possible, maybe in a week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks. Now, very common practices, 1 week releases, or 2 week releases, or 3 week releases because of Agile. Okay, right. Now, how it was followed? See, the whole story, DevOps story, right, is between this. So how you take the code, how you test it, how you package it, how you scan for vulnerabilities, and how you do all of checks, and how you release it. The whole story, right, DevOps story, is scoped under this software development lifecycle. Okay, so I want to talk about with DevOps and without DevOps. So without DevOps, how things were. Release cycles are longer. 1 year, yes, I worked in 1 year sprints. I worked in 6 month sprints. I worked in 4 month sprints. I also worked in 2 week sprints, 3 week sprints. Okay, so yes. See, when we say DevOps, right? See, the main idea of DevOps is iterating this cycle fast. Means there is a new feature that new. So the point of DevOps is how quick we can release this new feature to the customer. If you're not speaking, please stay on mute. Yeah, we hear some background noise. Yeah, thank you. Right. The whole idea of DevOps is how quick you can move this. If you can move this once in a week, that's good. If you can move this every day, that's even good. If you can move this once in 3 weeks, that's also good. So how fast you can move this process? That is what DevOps all about. So do anything, use any practices, use any tools, do anything to move this quick. You may follow some best practices. You may follow certain culture. You may apply tools. Okay. And the whole idea is move this faster. Right. Okay. You got it, right? So what is DevOps? So DevOps is combination of tools, practices, cultural philosophies, which enables organizations to release software rapidly and frequently. Okay, it should be seamless. So releasing a software right from development should be seamless. That's what DevOps is all about. So questions on that? Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So to achieve this, see, to move this life cycle quickly, they came up with Agile. They came up with continuous integration. They came up with continuous deployments, continuous delivery. They came up with configuration management. They came up with microservices architecture. Do you know microservices helps releasing your softwares faster? Yes, with microservices, we can release more features quickly, rapidly. So I'll explain how, why. Right. So let's start with Agile. I will first define what is DevOps. Then we will slowly start with how we achieve DevOps. So which enables organizations to be fast and
watching the put for command in Netflix, part one, part two, part.
They come again. Hello, are you speaking to me?
No.
Okay. Right. So that is what DevOps is about. It's a combination of practices, tools, cultural philosophies, which enables organizations to do fast and frequent software releases. How do we achieve DevOps? First thing, I will give point by point what we should really follow when we work in this model, right? So keep software development lifecycle short. Example, daily, monthly. Generally, keep it as short as possible. So, typical SDLC span is 2 to 3 weeks. Right. Follow incremental development. Hello? Incremental development means don't eat everything once. Eat small pieces. Okay? It's like this. So you have 100 requirements, you don't work on 100 at a time. Sprint one, maybe pick 5, finish it in 5 days or 10 days, then go and pick next 5, finish it, next 5, finish it. So this is best approach than taking all 100 and releasing it after 6 months. So see, working on all 100, releasing it after 6 months, working at working on 5 at a time, releasing every week, which makes more sense for the customer. Short releases makes more sense to the customer. Correct. So that's what it is. So follow incremental development. So what are the benefits, sir? So what benefits we get because of following incremental development? See, one developer working on, let's say, 5 tasks at a time. Right? And merging, it takes, let's say, it takes 40 days. So likewise, all developers are working on, let's say, 5 different things. It takes 40 days, or let's say it takes 60 days, 2 months. When they integrate all the changes, see, I'm just representing 2 developers. There could be 3 developers or 10 developers. So let's say after 50 days, these guys start integrating into a SCM tool, a source code management tool. See, there are lots of changes. When they integrate, any guess what happens? Is it going to be easy to integrate or difficult to integrate? See, if changes are more, if conflicts are more, it is very difficult and error prone to integrate versus take 1 at a time and integrate. Maybe you work on this for 5 days and integrate it. See, this is waterfall model actually. Waterfall, you parallelly work on so many things and the life cycle goes forward and never comes backward. I mean, if your design phase is done, you get into implementation. When you are in implementation phase, right? You can't come back to design phase. But so here, main problem is when you integrate too many changes there for integration, you have to literally sit for hours, days. I remember my days as a developer working on this kind of environment. So we literally spend 3 days, 4 days, sometimes 1 week only to merge. So after putting so much of time, efforts, we end up broken code. So we see some functionalities are broken. And again, go back, look into them, spend time, fix it, again, merge. So it's not a good practice, I believe. So working on so many things at a time and integrating them end of development phase is not really good practice, right? But here in Agile and in DevOps, we do incremental development. So Agile is also part of DevOps. Okay. So some people ask, what's the difference between Agile and DevOps? See, the Agile is about do incremental development and keep releases short, 1 week or 2 weeks, something like that. So which one you recommend here? This one or this one? This one. So in DevOps, right, you have to commit changes regularly, continuously. That's called continuous integration. You have to do this much every day. I mean, you means developer here. That's called continuous integration. Okay. So I highlight that. I mean, that falls in the Agile. Even this falls in the Agile. Commit changes to central code repository frequently or daily. Right. What else? We should work as a single team. We may have a development team, testing team, operations team, okay? And we all should work as one team. So we should know each other well. We should collaborate better. Collaboration is important. Okay, so collaboration is important. Why it's important? So, developers, test engineers, and DevOps engineers. They should work together as a single team to move this code from development to production faster, seamlessly. Collaboration is super important. And before DevOps, there was no collaboration. Yeah, there was collaboration between dev and testing team, but there was no collaboration between dev, testing, and operations team. So who is this? What is that operations mean here? Developers, these guys write code and they integrate here, for example, and test engineers, they test it, right? And finally, that code is deployed to prod. Prod means the servers where your customers are using your software. So who maintains this prod? Ops team. Ops team, or we call them operations team. So when DevOps was not there, no one knows. Even developers, they do not know where their code goes. Even testers, no, they do not have idea where their code goes. So there is operations team who is responsible for taking the code developed by this team and tested by this team and deploy that into production. And your customers use that. Maybe if it is Facebook here, facebook.com is your production environment. That's where everyone uses Facebook. So before changes release to production, Facebook will have test environment, Facebook will have a QA environment, development environment. So the code passes through all that environments, and after going through all different sort of checks, verifications, it released to prod and it's available over facebook.com. Right. So there was no, see, these guys do not know about this team and this team doesn't know about dev and testing team. So now we want to remove these barriers. They should not work in silos. There should not be any barriers. And of course, physically they are divided and virtually they should be united. Now in place of ops team, right? We have DevOps team. We call it DevOps team. That's what your job here. And you should closely work with testing team and development team. And even they should closely work with you. It's like a teamwork. No more silos. Everything should be merged. And you, sometimes you have to work beyond your scope. Sometimes possible. Maybe sometimes developers help your task. Maybe it's related to them more. And sometimes you help developers. That's what. So your role is packaging, testing, checking for vulnerabilities and successfully deploying, probably. But sometimes you have to closely interact with dev team or QA team, and they have to interact with you. And follow. Continuous integration, we call it CI. CI. DevOps all started on CI. I still remember days where people used to say CI tool, continuous integration tool. Okay. And that tool was Jenkins. Right. So Jenkins all started as a continuous integration tool, and it slowly evolved into a total DevOps automation tool. So even DevOps, right? It started with a few things, small things, and today it has so many things we follow and make this release process smooth and fast. Right. So what is continuous integration? How it helps in moving our software development lifecycle faster? Okay. See, in continuous integration, developers, right? Developers must integrate changes changes made by this guy, changes made by this guy should be integrated into a central repository. So in continuous integration, what happens? Developers must integrate changes to central repository several times a day. How it used to work in waterfall model, integration used to happen after development phase. If development phase takes 60 days, after 6 days, integration starts. So after 60 days, there are so many things we have to integrate, and we end up having so many conflicts. It consumes time and we make mistakes. So after integration, we end up having bugs. And again, we sit on them, we fix them. It's all time-based, right? It's all time-based. So we want to avoid that. So we want to follow continuous integration. So let's say a developer is done with one scenario, let him integrate that. If developer two is done with one scenario, let him integrate with that. So what's happening here is we are merging small changes. So we will not end up having lots of conflicts. If no conflicts, no bugs. Easy. So we are saving lots of time. And in terms of merging it, and in terms of fixing bugs after merge. So we are saving all the time, we're making the process faster and smarter. Continuous integration, I repeat again. So it's a development practice. It's not user, it is a developer who should follow this continuous integration. It's a development practice. So where developers commit changes to central repositories several times a day. and that code is automatically verified. See, when code comes to SEM, we will have Jenkins. Jenkins will check out the code. Jenkins will build the code. Jenkins will run test cases on the code, or even Jenkins can run vulnerability scanning on the code. Okay. So the moment code comes to SEM, there is a automated process, okay, which does all this stuff. When it is performing these checks, if it finds any defects, any issues, it sends a automated feedback. It sends automated feedback to development team. Means when a developer commits a change, within minutes, he gets a feedback if it has any issues. If there is compile time issue, maybe a test case failed, or there are some security vulnerabilities found, anything. So it gets a feedback immediately. So immediate feedback helps developers to fix it faster, rather getting slow feedbacks. Means in waterfall model, let's say developer did something 60 days ago, and now they are done with development cycle. They started integrating and we found 20 issues. So do developer remember what he did 60 days ago? Not really. So it is a rework. It's a rework. So that we are avoiding with help of continuous integration. CI for short is a development practice where right? Yeah. They integrate changes to central repository several times a day. Which is picked by an automated or automation tool. Compiles, runs test cases, right? That's okay. That's the advantage of following continuous integration practice. CI drastically improves productivity, drastically improves productivity. that is CI, follow CD. We have two flavors for CD, continuous deployment, continuous delivery. Right, they are pretty much same except one difference. Right, see, so continuous deployment, okay, it's again an automated process which begins after CI, which automatically deploys your code all the way from development to production. It's an automated process. So even this one, no. See that we are using automation. Automation. So look for repetitive tasks and automate it. Automation is key. Yeah, in continuous delivery, deployment to production happens with an approval. Yes, there is a manual approval before code gets deployed into production. CI is also an automation, CD also an automation, okay? So coming to interview questions, they ask, what is DevOps? Or they ask, what DevOps means to you? That's one interview question. And second interview question is, what is CI? What is CD, all that. Use microservices architecture. So this concept, microservices, is more of a development related and also DevOps related. So it's more of developers related, less of DevOps related. Okay, so what is this microservices architecture and how it helps our DevOps process? So have you heard about microservices architecture?
No worries.
So we had monolithic applications. Monolithic means one single big code base. Flipkart, it's very big application. It has huge code base. Google, big one. Amazon, big one. LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter. they're all big, eBay, they're all very big applications. When I say big, code base is also huge. Lots of code will be there. So you want to see that as a single application, then it is monolith. Okay, so dictionary meaning of monolith is a big rock. A big rock, right? So now, right. So one big application versus microservices application. See, again, I don't have to cover this probably when I talk about Docker, Kubernetes, but if time permits, I'll cover again one more time there. But anyways, let's talk about this. So monolith means a very big code base, everything is in one code repository. Everything is one single folder and subfiles, subfolders, and so on. What are the challenges? So what are the challenges? Yeah. Adding new features is a challenge. Why? Code is big. Making a small change also takes huge efforts. Because if you are introducing a small change, you don't know how it's going to impact the existing system, right? So if you want to introduce a small change, you need more time, more efforts. One problem. That's problem number one. Adding features or time taking. Number two, let's take this as a Amazon. Amazon follows microservices, but assume Amazon, when it was monolith, it had modules like Prime, for example, within that. Cart, inventory, orders, search, the many different components within that monolith. So now I want to scale only this. Means, let's say now Amazon is running this application on 100 servers. I want to scale only Prime. Can I scale only Prime? No. So that's not a separate service now. It is part of one code base. So I want to, let's say, set up 10 more servers. And on 10 more servers, I need to run complete application. It doesn't make much sense. See, I want to scale only this one. If I can scale only that one, my infrastructure cost will be less. See, I have to put everything again on my 10 servers. So that's second problem. See, adding new features takes time, means releasing that feature also takes time. It's against our DevOps process. So we can't scale applications effectively. We can scale, but I'm saying I want to scale only this, not everything. Problem number three. So to scale applications, we might need to choose a specific technology stack. For example, for Prime, I want to use MongoDB. For search, I want to use Elasticsearch. It's very difficult if it is one code base. Maybe we should depend on single database for everything. But for Prime, I want different database. For Elasticsearch, I want different database. For shopping cart, I want different database. Is that possible? No. Why I want different databases? To scale, to perform better. Okay. Yeah. We have to stick to same technology. Adding new members to the team is also challenging. Why it is challenging? If you hire a new person and you onboard it to this project, and no matter what is his experience, he needs some time to understand the system, understand the process, all that. So in big applications, it takes at least 4 to 6 months for any newcomer. He may have 10 years, 15 years, 2 years, 3 years, whatever. It takes 4 to 6 months to understand the system, understand the team environment, all that. So for 6 months, no productivity from this guy. We are paying for 6 months, but he's not adding value to the team. It's not his mistake, sir. That is our architecture mistake. Okay, so these are the problems and challenges with monolithic architecture. Now, this monolithic architecture, we want to keep it, throw it out, and we want to come up with microservices architecture. Yeah. Okay, so in microservices architecture, we're splitting that application into smaller services. Application one. Application two, application three, for example, application four. So here, microservice one, microservice two, microservice three, all belongs to same project, of course, but please stay on mute if you're not speaking. Yeah, see, we got multiple microservices. One could be payment, one could be orders, one could be Prime, one could be search, other one could be recommendations. So we are physically dividing them at code level, but again, we are virtually joining them as a project. So every microservice will have its own DB. And every microservice can be built on its own technology. Like I said, right? I want Elasticsearch here. I want MongoDB here. I want Postgres here. I want something else here. Yes, it's feasible now. Okay, plus, I want to scale only this. Yeah, put it on more servers. I want to scale only this. Yeah. Put it on more, sir. I don't have to scale everything now. So I can scale by microservice. Earlier, I had to scale the total application. And the release process of this could be independent, this could be independent, this could be independent, this could be independent. Okay. So if you have this as a one application, you may have, let's say, one release in 3 weeks, for example. But when you have one project, you got one release in 3 weeks. Let's say you use release 5 features. For example, I'm not saying it's always 5. I'm taking just an example. And let's say this monolith, you divided that into 4. And now they can be released separately. Let's say every time you release 5 features here, 5 features here, 5 features here, and let's say 5 features here. So you were releasing 5 features in 3 weeks when it was monolith. Now you are releasing, let's say, 20 features in same time. You're releasing more features, and you used to have one release. Now you're having 1, 2, 3, 4 releases. You got it, right? So how microservices architecture helps in DevOps? So microservices is an architecture. So we break that big application into smaller services. And explain, right? We get so many benefits because of microservices. And we will discuss more about this again when I introduce Docker and Kubernetes in the course. Got, right? What's the importance of microservices in the context of DevOps?
Yeah.
Then configuration management. What is it? So yeah, we should follow configuration management in our DevOps. I'll tell you. I want to set up 100 virtual machines, or I have 100 virtual machines. On 100 virtual machines, I want to install Java, install Tomcat, and configure SSL, etc. So if I do it manually, it won't be consistent. It is error prone. It takes time. But if I use a configuration management tool, I can automate that. See, in my DevOps role, someone gave me 500 virtual machines and they asked me to install Java. Simple. So one thing I can do is log into every machine, do that install process. It takes time. And even it's difficult to keep track of what servers I installed and what servers are not installed. It's very painful process. It takes time. It's painful process. So instead of doing that manually, see, if this takes time, and again, my release process also takes time. Yes or no? Yeah. So here I can be elegant and I can use configuration management tool and do the release process. Means for example, there are 500 VMs and so we have to install Java on them. Very simple one. configuration management tool, Ansible, Chef, right. Got it. So that's configuration management. It's a tool which automates installation and configuration of servers. And you want to do a patching on 1,000 servers. You want to apply patches on Linux machines, 1,000 Linux machines. I can automate that using configuration management. That's what configuration management is all about. Then monitoring. Lastly, logging. Monitoring is very important in production. We have to set up monitoring on our servers. Like you have to monitor databases, you have to monitor load balancers, you have to monitor your web applications, everything. You have to monitor for CPU, network performance, disk IO, memory utilization. You have to monitor everything. Why? We want to keep them healthy. So by monitoring, we can prevent server crashes. We can prevent downtimes. So monitoring is also important in DevOps. Logging. When you deal with big enterprise applications, you deal with tens, hundreds of servers, and they generate different log files. For example, a banking application, someone is using online banking, they made a transaction, it failed. And let's say they made a 50,000 transaction, it failed. So money debited from account, but that even didn't credit into that didn't credit into your friend's account. So it's in middle now. It's not with you, it's not with your friend, and it went somewhere. It is with bank, of course. So you got exception. And now there are hundreds, thousands of servers which is running online banking application. So it's difficult to pinpoint which server has that log file, right? So when there's exception, developers log those exceptions, and that is used for troubleshooting issues and helping customers when they have issues like I explained now. So you may have hundreds of servers and you can't go onto each server and find the log randomly. No, it's not possible. So logging means we set up a central logging server where logs are integrated into one single place. You may have thousands of servers and logs generated by thousands of servers gets into one central place. So we use ELK stack, Elasticsearch, Logstash, Kibana. ELK stands for. We can use Splunk. We can use Greylog. So there are different solutions for log management. We may be dealing with we need a central server to manage them so that it is easy to find and troubleshoot. And this monitoring log management generally comes under site reliability engineers. Make note of this. DevOps is a job role, and the site reliability engineers is also a job role. You check for that, SRE. When you search in Naukri, Monster, any job portal, you may search with this and see what kind of roles responsibilities they are expecting. So DevOps, site reliability engineering, right? They are like brothers. Sometimes you as a DevOps can play this role, and sometimes SREs can play your role. So there's a very thin line between these two roles. And their job is to make sure the site, the production site, is reliable by putting monitoring in place, by putting alerts in place, and making sure everything is going good. That's what their job is. Their job is to keep production environments healthy always. So that's what DevOps is all about, guys. And in the course, right, we will be looking into tools, philosophies, and practices. Most of them explained here, but we will see in practice. Okay, we'll see in practice.